Hello, and welcome to Rock, Paper, Swords, the historical action and adventure podcast. My name is Matthew Harvey.
My name is Stephen A. Mackay.
We're both best-selling historical fiction authors, and together we chat about all things historical and anything that could fall under the banner of action and adventure in books, film, TV, and games.
Oh, and we also talk about rock music from time to time.
Cue the music! Today's episode, we're honoured and overjoyed to welcome to the podcast a titan of historical fiction, the one and only Bernard Cornwell. Bernard is the author of over 60 novels and the non-fiction book Waterloo, the history of 4 days, three armies and three battles. His novels include the hugely successful Sharpe series, popularised by the TV series starring Sean Bean, and the more recent The Last Kingdom series, also known as the Saxon Stories, which became a very popular Netflix series. Bernard, you're largely responsible for both Stephen and I taking up writing, so it's a real pleasure and a privilege to have you on the podcast. So welcome.
Thank you.
First things first, we were going to ask you a bit about your new book, which is called Sharpe's Command. And if you could tell us a bit about that book and tell us a bit about why you decided to pick Sharpe up after a few years, first in Sharpe's Assassin last year, and now with Sharpe's Command.
I think the answer is I just missed him. I've lived with him for a very long time. I think there are now, with Sharpe's Assassin, 22 books, I think. I like his company, so I thought I'll do another one. And this one actually takes him back to 1812 and to the Almarez expedition, which was an extraordinary passage of arms. General Rowland Hill was asked by Wellington to march 100 miles behind the French lines and destroy a bridge at Almarez. And it was an extremely successful, though very difficult, expedition. And I thought, well, obviously Sharpe would quite like to be there, so he is there.
Yeah, Sharpe gets around a bit, doesn't he?
He has more lives than a basket full of cats.
It's true.
Do you have any more? Any more Sharpe novels coming after the newest one?
I honestly don't know. I'm tempted to write him into the next book I write, but it wouldn't really be a Sharpe book. It'd just be a character in the book, but I don't know.
Right. Ah, interesting. So any scoop on that book that you'll be working on next then?
If I knew it, I'd tell you, but it's just an idea at the moment, nothing more.
Have you done that before, writing character from one series into another series?
No, not really. I mean, there is a reference in Gallows Thief to a rifle officer who gives somebody very bad advice, and a lot of people think that must be Sharpe, and in fact it is Sharpe.
Okay, yeah, because I do it from time to time, and I read a lot of Stephen King, and Stephen King does it loads, self-referencing. It's quite amusing for people that have read, you know, all of his books.
And very self-indulgent too.
Yeah, it is very self-indulgent, but it's quite funny. I did think, I was reading Stephen King one recently, and Mr. Mercedes, it's not a new book, but it's reasonably new. And he self-references, like, people within the world reference a couple of his, you know, films and books and things. And yeah, I did think it was self-indulgent, but I also thought, how amazing to have such a huge impact on sort of modern culture that you can just self-reference like that, and it seems realistic that a policeman would be mentioning, you know, a movie or whatever. So talking about the Sharpe books, though, back to the Sharpe books, and you said how many you've written. So you said you think with Sharpe's Assassin it's 23. So I was looking, I reckoned it was 24, but I'm sure you're right. But
I wouldn't be sure of that at all.
Well, actually, I think it was 24 with the new one, with Sharpe's Command. So maybe we're probably both right. But I've heard different interviews with you and read things before and listened to things with you, and you've talked quite a lot about how you wrote the first Sharpe novel because you're in the States and you'd met your wife and you wanted to stay there, and it seemed like, you know, I'm telling your story here, but and it seemed like a way of you know, being able to stay in the States. But what would you have thought then if somebody had told you that in 2022 you were going to be about to publish your 24th Sharpe novel?
I'd have been terribly pleased, I think, but somewhat disbelieving. And I hate to correct what you just said, but I don't think I'm about to publish it. I had a ghastly summer with all sorts of medical problems and worse dental problems. And I lost a whole month because of a thing called the Cape Cod Shakespeare Festival. And I think we're going to have to delay the publication for a year.
Oh, your fans are going to be very disappointed, and that's including us, obviously. But
Well, I'm terribly sorry about it, but I mean, short of racing through to finish it in about 2 weeks, I'm not quite sure how else it's going to be possible.
Yes, yeah.
Maybe, it may be. That's really up to the publisher.
So that's an interesting... Firstly, I hope you're feeling better now and you've got through all of your dental problems and health problems and you're feeling up for, you know, writing and getting back in the saddle, as it were. But obviously your health comes first. I'm sure everyone understands that. But I know that you've been incredibly prolific. I mean, we talked about in the introduction that by the count on Wikipedia, it's something like 60 or over 60 novels. I kind of lost track. I tried to count myself and I got to 59 and then Wikipedia said 60. And I thought, oh, well, somewhere around there. But you've written, you know, loads of books, and obviously you've been some years, you know, writing multiple novels in a year. Have you ever missed a deadline before? Has that been anything has that happened to you before?
No, it's never happened before, which is why I feel very guilty about this one.
In some ways, you should feel less guilty, right? Because
good point.
You've done 60 novels and it hasn't happened. So,
I guess, yeah.
And people will be happy to wait. I'm sure they'll love it when it does come out.
Yeah, yeah. I can imagine though. I can understand how frustrated you must be, because I really pride myself on hitting deadlines. And I think, you know, obviously things come along that make it impossible to hit a deadline, like your health, obviously. And but yeah, I'd be incredibly frustrated if it happened to me. And I get very annoyed with people when they interrupt me and, you know, stop me and my family. You know, I have to sort of go around on tiptoes, I think, sometimes when I'm getting close to a deadline and feel like I need to
become a monster.
Yeah, a bit. Hopefully not too much. But so moving away from Sharpe for a minute, and this is kind of going back, harking back to right back into the 80s and early 90s, if you want to cast your mind back. You wrote 5 contemporary thrillers way back when. Of which I don't know how many I've read, but I do know I've read at least one, I think probably 2 or 3 of them. Wild Track, Sea Lord, Crackdown, Storm Child, and Scoundrel. I think one of them was a different name in the States. So what was the reason that you decided to write those contemporary books at that time?
I think I just wanted to try it. It was as simple as that. It was just, I thought, how easy would it be? Well, it wasn't easy. And did I like writing that kind of book? Which in the end, I decided I didn't. It was an experiment. I'm still quite fond of one or two of them. But
I remember reading them probably close to the publication date. And I can't remember. It was so long ago. I can't remember which one it was that I'd moved house and country since then and you know, lost all the books that I had, and so I don't know, but I remember enjoying them and thinking that, you know, that they were good. But so you said you didn't enjoy writing them.
Yeah, you just prefer historical fiction then.
Well, I think 95% of the effort of writing a book is getting the story right, and I think I've just found it easier to get historical novels right than contemporary thrillers. Mm-hmm. As simple as that.
So here's a bit of a geeky question, I suppose, or nerdy, being another, you know, from a writer's perspective, just thinking, if you didn't really enjoy it, did you write 5 because you'd signed a contract for 5?
No, just being stubborn. I mean, back then, I was, for a start, I was very much younger, and I didn't find it impossible to write two books a year. So it was one Sharpe a year and then anything else in the second half of the year. I think I was just being stubborn just to keep going doing it. And then I finally decided you don't enjoy doing it, so why keep going? So I went back to his purely historical novels.
That's interesting.
I'm glad you did.
Yes, I'm sure you've got a lot of readers out there that are very, very happy that you made that decision. You've returned, as we said, to the Sharpe novels recently. You've just quite recently finished the Uhtred Last Kingdom series. Have you got any plans to return to any of your other series of books?
I don't think so, no. Although I would like to take the hero of Gallows Thief and put him through another gallop. And that may happen, but I don't think so. I think from now on, it's going to have to be probably standalone novels. I'm getting too old to think about a new series.
Well, they do have a tendency to become very long series, don't they? So.
Well, they do, yes. I mean, I was sorry to see the back of Uhtred, but I really thought his story was over. And I'm not tempted to go back to him, although people ask me to. There's really no great gaps in his story. So, whereas Sharpe, there are gaps in Sharpe's story.
Yeah, you can fill them in.
And it's always a pleasure to write Sharpe. I do enjoy his company, grumpy sod that he is, but he's fun to have around.
Yeah, I mean, I think all of your protagonists tend to be quite grumpy and stubborn.
Yeah, it's much the same, isn't it?
Well, I like to put myself in my books.
Well, I was thinking about your stubbornness. I was thinking, yeah, that's probably something of you in your characters. But you never seem very grumpy, though. Every time I see you in interviews, you don't seem grumpy.
Yeah, you're smiling in all the pictures. We've got this TV adaptation.
TV adaptation of the Arthurian books, yeah. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, we're looking forward to that immensely.
Yeah, they're being filmed right now. Right. Well, televised. Very little about it, except they're filming in South Wales and the West Country, which is the right place to do it.
Yeah.
I love those three books, and I'm really delighted that a TV company has picked them up.
Yeah, I mean, I think those three books are they're definitely the books of yours that got me wanting to write and starting to write.
Yeah, me too.
Mm-hmm. So,
yeah, we both absolutely love them. I listened to the Audible editions a couple of years ago as well again, and they're just brilliant. They're definitely my favourite work of yours.
My wife recently wanted to listen to the Audibles of them, and so we did it in the car on a long journey, and I had to turn it off after 5 minutes.
Why?
I don't believe I could have written that sentence that badly. You know?
I think that's interesting because I think a lot of people, because both Stephen and myself are members of the Bernard Cornwell fan club on Facebook, so we see lots of comments from people, and often new people join and they say, I've just read this book, and what do you think? Which book should I read next of Bernard's? And people, you know, there's lots of comments. Obviously, it's people who are fans of yours, so it's always very positive. But when people discuss, love those books, they're fantastic. But the first part of the first book, people often comment that it was difficult to get into. I didn't have that problem when I read it first, but
no, me neither.
But it's interesting though.
No, looking back on the three when I'd finished them, I thought if I had my life over again, I'd rewrite the first third of the first book.
Well, there you go. Yeah. So, but that's the life. That's the life of a writer, though, isn't it? You can't do that.
Yeah,
although some writers
happy,
do, I guess.
I don't know. Films get a director's cut. I don't see why books shouldn't have an author's cut.
That's a fair point. Yeah. You could, yeah.
I've actually read, and going back to Stephen King, we talked about self-indulgent. If he listens to this podcast, he won't like it. But he did. I did read The Stand by him, and it was the writer's cut, as it were. It was like an extra 300 pages or something. So it's like another novel stuck in there.
Self-indulgent, indeed.
Well, maybe I should do it. Maybe I should rewrite that first third.
Yeah, nothing to stop you now. Yeah.
Sounds like a plan. I mean, it's a great book anyway. So those books are brilliant. And they are amazing. I mean, it makes me think though. So you did in the late 80s, early 90s, you did these contemporary books and you tried your hand at those and then decided, you know, maybe not for me. And then the Arthurian, although it's historical, they obviously are verging on fantasy. You know, it's based, it's all very real and gritty and believable, but it is, they are myths, and they're taken from legend and myth. Have you ever thought about writing any other fantasy books and going, you know, maybe more that direction?
Whenever I think that, I go and lie down until the feeling passes.
Well, I always think that fantasy is just historical fiction, but easy, because you can just make it up.
Yeah, make everything up.
I think I don't make up historical fiction.
Well, well, obviously, yeah, but you're somehow tethered to the reality. You kind of, yeah. You know, you're trying to hit the, at least it needs to be believed. People are going to say, you know, it's not believable. Yeah.
There are some very good writers in the fantasy field. I think I'll stay where I am.
Seems reasonable.
I tried very hard not to make them too fantasy. I mean, Merlin does what appears to be magic, but I always have him explain how he did it.
Yep.
I remember the girl glowing in the dark.
Well, that's funny you should say that, because that was my next question. Piddox.
Piddox, that's right. Yeah. I never did the experiment. I never found Piddox and sort of smeared my wife with them. But
that was your question, wasn't it, Steve?
That wasn't my question. Sure, was if any of your readers had ever tried it and told you about it?
I can't remember how I found out about it, but I was assured by somebody that it would work.
I think it was Plato, because I read an interview with you yesterday. I'm sure it was Plato or something like that that mentioned it.
It was like the delightful discovery when I wrote Fools and Mortals, that the actors, especially the boys playing women, could take crushed pearls and mix them with a grease, which they put on their face, and then their face would glitter
right.
in the candle. Really?
There are great moments, great moments of research like that that really help things shine.
Yeah, they make the book that bit more special and magical without it actually being magic.
And really, with the Arthur books, I wanted to take him back to a realistic 5th and 6th century setting. I mean, get rid of plate armor, get rid of soaring stone castles, and also make Lancelot into a villain.
Yeah.
I mean, it's great.
By Chrétien de Troyes, and it takes a Frenchman to put adultery into a good British story.
Yeah, he's quite a later addition, isn't he, Lancelot? He certainly captured the Dark Age feel of that whole series, I think. It was very realistic, but still magical at the same time.
I enjoyed writing them enormously. I mean, they're probably the greatest pleasure to write of all the books I've ever written. And I've never dared reread them.
Oh, they are great. I have, you know.
Yeah, they're still great. Yeah.
So a geeky question about them, though. I mean, so I do love the fact that you kept them really grounded, and they were basically feels like history, but everybody believes in magic, which is something that, you know, obviously I'm sure was true, that lots of people did believe in, you know, the spirits and magic and the other worlds and things. So Merlin can play on that. That's great. But a geeky question that I've got here is I noticed that the Arthur books are published by a different publisher to your other books in the UK. What's the reason for that, really? Why did that happen?
The reason for that was I had a wonderful editor called Susan, who is still my editor after 40-odd years. And in a fit of madness, HarperCollins fired her.
Wow.
And she was picked up by Michael Joseph Publishers. And she knew I wanted to write two books a year. So she said, well, why don't you write a book for me? And HarperCollins didn't have an exclusive contract with me at that time. So I wrote those for Susan. And they're still obviously published by Michael Joseph and people. And then HarperCollins had the wit to hire a back again.
Well, that's fantastic. So did you, sorry, Stephen. So you're writing two books. When you're writing the Arthur books, you're writing two books a year at that stage?
It's one Sharpe and one Arthur.
All right, I think, Stephen, you've got a question here.
Oh, yeah.
The Last
Kingdom TV series. When that came out, which I really enjoy, there was a lot of online chat about people complaining about various kind of to me, silly things like the armour wasn't period correct, the weapons weren't right for the time. Uhtred was too pretty, which I actually agree with. He's a very handsome man, but he grew into the role brilliantly as he got older and stuff, and he was perfect for it. But do you ever take any notice of things like that, like the criticisms with kind of minor points like that?
No, my gratitude to them overcomes any complaints. I mean, I thought it was beautifully done. I really did like it, and I thought that the casting was good.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people complained to me that the stories were changed. But TV people always change stories. They have constraints I don't have. I mean, if I'm writing a Sharpe book and in the middle of the book, I think the plot is getting a little bit flat, I can wheel on 40,000 Frenchmen and have Sharpe said about them, but you know, it costs them enormous amounts of money to do the same thing. So I really liked it, and I often admired what they did with the stories. I mean, at times, some people claim that the plot got a little confusing. I remember my wife one night as we were watching it saying, "Why did he do that?" I said, "I don't know, I only wrote the damn books." But it all came out right in the end.
But it's great that you could enjoy the series as a viewer in that way.
We always do. We don't get any preview of it. And the only episode which I must sort of register a complaint for was, I think, Series 7, Episode 3, where Alexander killed me.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, you were on it.
And I complained that this was unfair, that in any straight fight I'd have killed him. But no one has believed me so far.
Yeah, I don't know. I think you were having a piss, though, weren't you, or something at the time, and he comes up behind you.
That's right, yes. So. And I'm very proud of that, oddly enough, because the director said, "We have to separate you from the others. How do we do that?" And they were looking for an excuse for me to be on my own. I said, "Well, I'll just stop at the stream and have a piss." And he said, "Perfect, do it."
As you do. Yeah. It's got to happen. So I think at that point, you know, Uhtred would just about beat you. Alexander Draiman there, or Damon. Is it Damon? Draiman?
Draiman.
Draiman, yeah. He would just about be able to get the edge on you if you've got your back to him and you're having a piss.
And he was a splendid Uhtred.
He was. Well, he still is, because I don't think it's finished yet.
No, it's not finished. There's a 2-hour Netflix film coming next year. I guess they're cutting it right now.
Okay.
So, brilliant. So, filming's been completed, hasn't it, on that?
Filming is completed on that, yeah. Okay. But I always said of Alexander the same thing I said of Sean Bean, that he only got the part because he looks like me.
Yeah. I'm vaguely remembering now about Sharpe and Sean Bean, that obviously you'd written some of the novels first and then the series got picked up, and obviously Sean Bean's got quite a strong accent. And is it right that you then changed his accent, or you gave him an excuse for having that accent in the novels?
No, the excuse was already in the novels, that he'd spent time in Yorkshire.
Okay.
And I have to say, I thought Sean was the perfect Sharpe, absolutely perfect.
Yeah, I don't think anybody would disagree with that.
Anybody doing Sharpe better. He got him just spot on.
He's a great actor.
Yeah. So that'd be interesting if the... I mean, so here's a question. I don't know the answer to this. Lots of the novels of the Sharpe books have been done as TV films or whatever that you call it. How many have not been done? Because obviously you've got these new couple. How many others are there sitting around?
I'm honestly not sure. I never tried to match them up. As you say, the two new ones. But they didn't do Sharpe's Trafalgar. That would have been a bit costly.
Yeah.
Maybe nowadays with CGI and the special effects, I could manage it.
Yeah.
I'll put onto them.
I
rather regret that, because Trafalgar is one of my favourite books. Mm-hmm. I think they more or less covered the whole lot. They made up a couple of stories themselves. Sharpe's Justice was one.
Did you enjoy that one, or was it weird to watch something that you hadn't written?
Yeah, I always enjoyed watching Sean. Yeah. I enjoyed the whole, I actually rewatched the whole series last year, and I thought they held up very well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I watched some of them because I was living in Spain at the time that they came out, and obviously they were huge in Britain, and they weren't. You know, we had Curro Jimenez in Spain, so it was one of the Spanish sort of desperados fighting the I don't know what you call them, the guerrillas, you know, fighting the Napoleonic soldiers. There was a series on TV in Spain about him, so that's kind of the same type of series, I guess. But so I sort of missed them the first time around. My wife a few years ago bought me the box set of the DVDs, and I've watched some of them sort of, you know, working my way through. But yeah, they do stand up. I think they still really do stand up. And as you say, Sean's fantastic. So both moving on from Sharpe and touching back to a novel that you mentioned already, a standalone, Fools and Mortals. So both Stephen and I, both are performers, and Stephen sings and plays instruments. I sing and like to act as well. In fact, in a couple of months, I'm appearing in a pantomime, bizarrely enough.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And I know that you like acting and theatre as well. And of course, we've talked about the fact that you appeared in one of the Uhtred episodes, one of the Last Kingdom episodes. And you mentioned before, I don't know if it was on when we were recording or before, but you mentioned to us about the Cape Cod Theatre Festival, Shakespeare Festival. I know you've been involved with them in the past. Can you tell us a bit about that, your involvement in acting?
I mean, really, I went down from two books to one book a year because I fell among actors. And we had a wonderful theatre in the little town where I live, called the Monomoy Theatre. And every summer, they collected students, drama students from all across North America, and they put on 8 plays in 10 weeks.
Wow.
And for some reason, they wrote me in. And I absolutely loved it, absolutely adored it. I didn't adore all of it. I once had a solo in a musical, and I still wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning in a cold sweat. But on the way, I played Prospero, Henry IV, Toby Belch, and played in a lot of other productions of Chekhov and Lord knows who else. And I did really, really, really enjoy it. Well, about 3 years ago, the theatre was bought out from underneath us by a developer who was sadly letting it decay. I think so he can eventually persuade the town that the only fate for it is to be pulled down and he can put up houses. But this year we brought back a thing called the Cape Cod Shakespeare Festival, and we did 2 plays. We did them in a park, and they were hugely successful. And we think we're going to do it again next year, and we hope to make it an annual event. So this year I was in Twelfth Night playing Toby Belch, and in Midsummer Night's Dream playing Peter Quince.
Oh, brilliant. So...
And that was another reason why the book is delayed.
Yeah, because you spent that month doing that. And how much rehearsing? Yeah. How much rehearsing do you do before that then, if it's over a few weeks in the summer?
Well, it's all day rehearsals for 2 weeks.
Okay.
Rehearsing one play in the morning and the second play in the afternoon. It was a pretty tight schedule, but we got through it.
It's a lot to remember.
Yes. Yeah. So obviously, as a result of that, I'm pretty sure it was a direct result of that love of Shakespeare that saw you write Fools and Mortals.
It really was, yes. And I can remember, I mean, I think one of the reasons they asked me to join was they thought my accent was the right accent for Shakespeare, which it probably isn't. But going through a process of seeing the plays being cast and then rehearsed, I thought nothing really has changed since 1595. And also the best way to learn Shakespeare or to get to know him is to be in his plays. And I was in a play every year for 12 years. And became more and more fascinated and ended up doing a hell of a lot of research and then writing Fools and Mortals.
Ah, that's interesting. Yeah, so you talked about doing a hell of a lot of research and obviously having to move into a different time period that you're not a specialist in. You had to do a lot of research. And how did you find that? Because I know you've written so many Sharpe novels and now so many Uhtred novels as well. I'm assuming you're not having to do such deep dives when you write those. When you wrote just a one-off set in Elizabethan period, how did that
Well, I think it was 2 years concentrated reading. And of course, there's so much to read on Shakespeare. And I chose as the background to the book, A Midsummer Night's Dream, because I'd already been twice, so I knew the play pretty well. I enjoyed that research, and partly because I was so fascinated by Shakespeare's world. So really the research was a pleasure. It isn't always a pleasure, but that was a pleasure.
Yes, I mean, I studied theatre at school, and I remember we studied Midsummer Night's Dream, and I acted in it at school, and I read Fools and Mortals, and I really enjoyed it because I I knew the play as well. And I think it makes a big difference if people know the production that they're talking about.
And that's probably the best known of his plays, certainly of the comedies. And I'd also, in my earlier acting career, played Max Reinhardt in Shakespeare in Hollywood, which is one of the greatest comedies ever written.
There's a kind of a perception that authors, writers are introverted and just like to be on their own all the time. Obviously, the three of us like to be on stage and in front of people. So do you think, Bernard, that's a kind of natural thing? Are all authors not really as introverted as they're made out to be?
Well, I think you have to like being on your own. I mean, I think writing, like something else, is a solitary vice. And I mean, I actually enjoy it. I mean, the writing, that is.
Yeah.
probably the other as well.
I don't think you could do it for 40 odd years if you don't enjoy it. Part of that is the way I write. I mean, I cannot plan a novel out. I never have been able to. I've tried, and it just doesn't work for me. So I write a novel to find out what happens. And granted, I can change what happens and usually have to. But part of the pleasure of writing for me is the same as the pleasure of reading, to discover what happens. But at the same time, I did enjoy being in the theatre simply because for 3 months every summer, I was surrounded by 20 to 30 young people who were incredibly clever, incredibly enthusiastic, often very funny, sometimes very beautiful, and irreverent, and just immense fun to be with. And given that choice, I would rather spend that 3 months in their company than working on a book.
Right.
Yeah,
So you never plan any books. None of them have been planned out, really.
None of them have been planned out. And I have literally got to the last chapter of a book and thought, how the hell do I finish this? And I'm rather in that situation with the new Sharpe's command, because I'm actually writing the ending of the book. It's still got about, I think, at least two chapters to go, but I really can't quite see how it's going to end. But I have great faith that Sharpe will find a way.
Yeah, it will come to you somehow, yeah.
So I've heard you say this before, and I'm always very, I'm just very envious and a bit sceptical, because I have to plan. I find, the fear of launching into the unknown for 100,000 words and not knowing where I'm ending, going to end the book.
I think you're very lucky if you can plan.
Well, they're probably rubbish to plan. In the end, I think the most exciting bits are when, because I don't plan in incredible detail, I get the most fun bits are the bits that leap out and suddenly I think, oh, this will work, and something just happens. Yeah,
yeah, character drives it.
A character suddenly does it.
Where a book is going to end. I mean, obviously, if you're writing about the Battle of Salamanca, the book is going to end with the Battle of Salamanca. The problem is getting Sharpe to Salamanca with enough enemies around him to make it an interesting journey.
That's something I always really admire, that of your Sharpe books, how in very what are essentially quite short books, you manage to bring in all these sort of personal vendettas and shenanigans with Sharpe, and then get him to the final conclusion, the big battle, and you have the big set piece, but he's also got these personal enmities there. I think that's incredibly clever. It works really well.
Well, I hope it's working right now for Sharpe's command. And when I've got to the big ending, and because I always knew what the ending is the destruction of the bridge. But there are one or two loose ends to tie up.
I can't wait to read it. I'm sure it'll be perfect in the end.
I hope so.
So do you read any new historical fiction, Bernard, or try reading different genres just to kind of inspire yourself and maybe help you evolve in your own kind of writing, find new ways to say things?
I'll be honest, I prefer other genres.
Right, right.
And the only reason for that is that for 42 years now, I've been writing historical fiction.
Uh-huh.
It's a long day. I normally start around 7:30 and finish around 5 or 6 o'clock at night. And the last thing I want to do in the evening is read another historical novel. Because yeah. Whenever I do, I know exactly what they're doing.
well,
which is no bad thing. And occasionally I do read one, and I get sent an awful lot of novels. People saying, would you please read this? And either encourage a publisher to read it or make a comment on it. And I try to do that, but I get too many. I mean, I've probably got 20 novels piled up in this room here, which mm-hmm. are all of that category. But occasionally I'll read one and absolutely love it.
I think so many of the historical fiction authors like us are inspired by you. So if you read one of our books, you would probably see the similarities where we are kind of emulating you to an extent. So I can see why you really wouldn't want to read it, especially if I'm not going to be as good as you. It would probably be quite boring for you.
Well, I'm sure they can be as good as me. That reminds me of a story. A book was published some time ago. I don't remember when. I don't remember the name of the book, but the publisher, their sort of puff line on the book was better than Bernard Cornwell.
I know the one you mean. I know who you mean.
I think about 2 years later, they sent me a book asking if I'd make a comment on it. And I said, why don't you get the person who's better than me to do it?
Yeah, I remember that tagline. I thought it was quite cheeky,
yeah.
The publisher to use that. And I'm sure the author had no part in it.
I'm sure he didn't, but they were offering their money back, your money back.
Oh, that's right.
I know the one.
Yeah, it's Angus.
Angus Donald, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Says as good as Bernard Cornwell, right, your money back. Money back.
Yeah.
He told me that one person asked their money back.
That was me. Not really. We're both quite like Angus.
Yeah, he's a great guy. He's a fun guy. So. But yes, I'm sure the publishers they came up with that tagline. It definitely wasn't him. And I think he'd be mortified to think.
I'm sure he will be when he hears this.
He will. Yeah. He'll probably hear this. Yeah. He'll be like, oh my God. Anyway.
Well, for all I know, he may have been right.
Well, as I remember it, if we are talking about the Angus Donald one, it said, as good as Bernard Cornwell or your money back. So I don't think it is better. So, you know, maybe.
I've actually got the book, but I've never read it. I did buy it.
I confess I haven't read it either.
Well, I did write Robin Hood books at the same time as he was writing those. So I thought I bought it, but I never read it because I didn't want to get accused of stealing ideas from him.
That's a good reason not to.
Yeah.
Not to read it. I remember when I wrote the Arthur books and was doing the research, did not read any of the Arthurian novels because it would be so easy, one, to get influence and two, to be accused of stealing an idea.
Mm. I did the complete opposite. Every time I'm getting stuck on a book, I read one of yours, Bernard, and just hope that some of your genius will rub off on me.
Well, I did actually steal the Piddocks idea for one of my books where they smeared themselves in the shellfish to make themselves glow in the dark.
It's not my idea. It's out there.
But I did get it from you, though, and I'm quite honest, open to admitting it.
You have these solicitors will be contacting you soon. You talked a bit about, you said that you work from 7:30 to 5 sometimes, or 5:30, so long days sometimes. We've got quite a few writers that listen to this podcast and obviously very interested in what other writers do, what their process is. And obviously for you, it's been a very successful process. You said you don't plan your books, but what's a sort of typical day for you and how do you plan ahead and what are your sort of deadlines and all that? How does that work?
I literally do not plan ahead. I mean, it's pick up where you left off yesterday and keep going. I mean, I quite like to leave, say, an episode in a book unfinished, because then I know exactly what I'm doing next morning, that you're up to speed very fast. But it really is sitting down every day and thinking, okay, what happens next?
That's a very good tip.
Yeah, so sort of halfway through a scene, because then you know
what
the conclusion
of
the scene is going
to be. I think I'll have to try that. That's a good idea.
Fair. Yeah, that makes the next day easy. Mm-hmm. Start.
So what about in terms of targets that you set yourself? Are you writing for a set number of hours or a set number of words or pages?
I keep my bum on the seat for a set number of hours because it's a job, like any other job.
Yeah.
You have to turn up and do it. And of course, there are days when it's really like swimming through treacle. and that's okay too, because it just means that the book is going in the wrong direction. So it's time to go back a chapter and push it in another direction.
But if you don't plan it beforehand, do you just then think about it in the shower or whatever in that morning before you sit down to write, so you've got some idea of where things are going to develop next? Or do you just sit down and hope it develops from where
you
sit?
Well, the book tends to consume you. I mean, whenever I'm walking the dog, I'm hearing the characters have conversations in my head. And you're quite right. A shower is a great place to get a good idea.
Yeah, or the car or something.
And yeah, it's... And you're thinking about it all the time, and for all I know, dreaming about it too. But I'm quite sure that a vast amount of work goes on in the subconscious. And I mean, I can't tell you the number of times that I've thought I have no idea what Sharpe can do next, or another character. And the answer seems to come from nowhere.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm glad it's not just me. That definitely happens. The number of days that you say about sitting, you know, like you're wading through treacle and you don't know exactly where you're going, and then maybe walk the dog, take a break or something, and then suddenly, or maybe that night or in the shower, you know, yeah, suddenly boom, something walks happens up. So you just think, oh, I know what can happen. And sometimes it's a tiny change, or you know, just, you know, very small incident that can really shift the whole, you know, the direction of a story for the better, you know, and can fix it. It's amazing.
And then other days are spent correcting.
Hmm.
I mean, I always think of it, I always call it putting doorways in alleys, which I've described before. So yeah, Stop if you've heard it. But I mean, inevitably, in almost every book, Sharpe gets trapped in a blind alley and his sword is broken and his musket or his rifle is unloaded. And he's faced by 20 Frenchmen with fixed bayonets and loaded muskets who taunt him by saying, "We've got you, you're dead." And the truth is he is. And you think, well, there's nothing I can do about this. So the answer is to go back. Let's suppose that's taking place in chapter 10. You go back to chapter 3 and you set another scene in exactly the same alley. It can be a very small scene. It doesn't have to be an important scene, but the important thing is that you put a door in the alley so it's no longer blind.
Right.
And they say, "Aha, you're a dead man, Mr. Sharpe." He jumps through the door. And the reader doesn't feel treated because they always knew there was a door there. If you just make up the door on the spot, then they're going to feel cheated, and they are being cheated. So I waste days putting doors into alleys. Little tiny things that are going to come together in the right place to make life easier for Sharpe to win. It's very unfair, but then Sharpe never did approve of a fair fight anyway.
No,
another good tip for the writers listening to this.
You said you waste days. I don't think it's wasted if it's making the story work. I think that's probably
waste days. Trust me, I can waste whole days.
You said you mentioned the wading through treacle thing, and that you said that gives you the you realize that when you're doing that, it sort of gives you the nudge to change something and go back if it's too difficult to do the writing. I don't do that. I'm stubborn, but I just keep going and think it's going to get better. And I keep going until somehow it sort of come out the other end. And maybe that's because I plan at high level, so I sort of know where I'm going. But I often go back and read those days of writing and think, actually, it's fine.
You can learn a great tip from P.G. Woodhouse, who, like me, was a very English writer living in America. And when he was writing his quite brilliant books, it was all on a typewriter, of course, back then. And as he finished a page, he would take the page and he would pin it to the wall. Now, if he thought it was a really good page, it went very high up on the wall. If it was a really lousy page, it went to the very bottom, and if it was in the middle, he put it somewhere in the middle. And by the time he'd finished a chapter, there were these pages all over the wall, and he'd go back to the pages that were at the bottom and improve them and so on. And I feel much the same. I mean, I used to do it on a typewriter too. And I used to remember the old advice to Spitfire and Hurricane pilots in World War II, never fly straight and level for more than 20 seconds. And I'd look at each page and think, am I flying straight and level, or have I surprised somebody? Have I put an injector some excitement in? If I hadn't, it was time to redo that page.
Yeah, had a fight scene or something.
And I still feel that you've got to keep the reader's interest, even in... I mean, usually the hardest part to write of a book is the middle. You know, you've set the whole thing up in the first four or five chapters, and you've got a great big ending, which you can't wait to get to, but then you've got to get to it through five or six more chapters. And keeping the interest alive in those middle sections can be a challenge.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I always find the action scenes kind of write themselves. They're quite easy to write. It's, you know, excitement and, you know.
And quite tiring to write too.
Tiring to write, you
say? Yes, I always feel more tired after describing a battle. Don't know why.
I think writing in general is quite tiring. I mean, I think we were talking about how much goes on in the subconscious when you're writing and when you're not writing. And I think when you're properly in the depths of a draft of a novel, after sitting down all day, because I sit down all day writing the same as you, and I think by the end of the day, you know, you're quite mentally drained. I think somebody who doesn't do it would be quite surprised at how tiring it is. It doesn't feel like a real job, but obviously you have to make it a real job by sitting down.
It is a real job. Yeah. And you burn that glass of whiskey at 5:30 every night.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hopefully a funny question here. Do you have a favourite review of any of your books, Bernard? Like even a funny review or a really bad one?
I have a favourite review, yes. It was in the Washington Post, where a guy, and I can't remember his name, although I have the review somewhere, and at the bottom it said, whatever his name was, is writing his first novel. And his opening line was, Bernard Cornwell cannot write a novel. And it then got worse from there, which is fine. That was his opinion. But I can't wait for that first book to come out, and I will volunteer to do it.
Yeah, that one, the one you accept for the endorsement, right?
And I on the whole, don't read any reviews because I think the good ones go to your head and the bad ones go to your heart. And
it's a good way of putting it.
I also think that, like most writers or like most artists, you know whether the book is any good or not. And I really believe that if you don't have a self-appreciation of the value of your work, then you shouldn't be doing it.
That's an interesting, because there's like a healthy self-criticism. And I think you're right, you need to have that to be able to critique your own work and be honest. But at the same time, I think many writers, and maybe at different stages of the life of a book or, you know, maybe their career, will really second guess themselves too much and go back and rewrite and ponder. Yeah. And I often talk to people about it, and they say, you know, I'm writing a book. How do I finish? How do I get beyond, you know, going over and over and over and making it perfect? And
well, I think that's true, especially of beginning writers, because you have no idea really whether what you're writing is publishable or whether anyone will like it if it is published, and you tend to overwork it. But having written 60 novels, I think I ought to know what I'm doing.
Hopefully.
Yeah, we think you do.
Yes, I think you. Yeah, I think we can safely say that you've got some sort of idea anyway.
Yeah.
Well, at the end of every episode, we ask all of our guests a certain number of questions. And you, this is no exception, Bernard, you're no exception to this rule. So we're going to ask you, what have you been reading and watching this week or the last couple of weeks?
Lord, the last thing I watched was the original film of MASH.
Oh, right.
Which came out in the 60s, and I hadn't seen it since the 60s, and thoroughly enjoyed it. But reading. I've just finished Ian Toll's trilogy on the American War in the Pacific, which I think is the finest history book I've read in years. Trilogy.
Interesting. So is that a period in history that you'd be interested in writing about?
No, too many ghosts, too many people still alive who remember it. But Ian Toll has written an utterly superb trilogy. I think the first one is called The Incoming Tide, then Pacific Crucible, and I can't remember the title of the third one, but they're absolutely brilliant. And it's Ian Toll.
Okay.
If you want to have a good, solid read, it won't disappoint you.
Great recommendation.
And I do tend to read a hell of a lot of history. I mean, right now I've got about 5 books on the go. And I read novels too, but it's always thrillers. I'm a huge fan of Mick Herron.
Okay.
Just wish he'd write a bit faster. I think that's about it. Does that cover it for you?
That covers it, yeah.
Yes, we have a final question. So, this is a two-part one for you. What have you been listening to in terms of music? And do you listen to music when you write?
No, I don't.
No.
I think it would be rather off-putting. And I'm not a great music fan. If I listen to music, it tends to be, you have to forgive me for this, liturgical music of the 16th to the 19th century. I mean, if I listen to anything, it would be Fauré's Requiem. I do like choral music for some reason, but I think my taste in what you'd call modern music probably ended with Van Morrison.
Okay. So no Def Leppard or, you know.
Whoever he is, no. I'll obviously have to listen to Stephen, but is it on YouTube? I can listen to it there.
Oh, is that saying this? But listening to you saying about listening to Stephen, did you say?
Yes.
Oh well, you can hear me and Matthew actually on the theme song for this podcast.
Okay, great.
So when you hear the episode, you'll hear us.
Maybe it will reawaken my interest in music.
hopefully.
You never know. Yeah. Well, thanks, Bernard. You've been a fantastic guest, and it's been absolute pleasure. You know, for both. Well, definitely for me, and I'm sure I can speak for Stephen.
Yeah, well, we're both actually quite nervous because we are such big fans of yours. So for us, this is like us meeting a rock star.
So, oh dear, I was nervous too.
Well, we didn't think you would be.
Before we came on, I said to Stephen, I said, I bet Bernard's nervous too. And he said, I don't think so. And I said, well, you know, probably everybody gets nervous before they do something like this. But
I'm just sorry the camera didn't work.
That's okay. I still think it's because you're sitting there naked and you didn't want us to see. So,
but you have great insight, Matthew.
Great imagination.
But anyway, it's been fantastic. And
yes.
Best of luck for the remaining chapters of Sharpe's Command. And whatever happens with the release date, I hope it all works out well. And
I hope your health gets better very soon.
My health is actually okay at the moment, but I had to be opened up 3 times to get.
Wow.
That's the scary thing. You go into an operating theatre, and I remember the very first operation I ever had. And it was one, it looked like a National Health Hospital that was in America. And nowadays, it looks like the launch command for a space thing. I mean, there are vast television screens everywhere. And as they're about to put me under, I say, can I watch the Super Bowl in here?
Yeah, gosh. Yeah, well, I'm glad you got through the operations okay and that you're
that too.
Back on your feet and or on your bum writing.
Yep.
So it's been fantastic to meet you, even without seeing you. And, yeah, best of luck for everything. And maybe one day when you're over in the UK doing one of your book tours or book signings, maybe we will meet face-to-face.
That would be very nice. Thank you, Matthew. Thank you, Stephen.
Thank you very much, Bernard.
Thank you. That's it for today's episode. We hope you've enjoyed it as much as we have. It's been great meeting Bernard, don't you think?
It really has, yep. Rockstar.
It's been fantastic.
True rockstar.
I can't believe it, actually. And so I'm going to have to go and have a stiff whiskey, as he talked about, yeah. And pinch myself. So I'm sure, like all of us, like both of us, I'm sure the listeners are just as pleased to have heard Bernard. So please let us know if you have any questions or things you'd like us to cover in future episodes. You can contact us on the Facebook page, facebook.com/rockpaperswordspodcast, or on Twitter at @rock_swords. You can find more about our books on matthewharfy.com and stephenamackay.com. We're also both on Twitter individually as well. So drop by and say hello. And we're on Facebook as well. I don't know if I said that. The theme music is written and performed and copyrighted by us. So until next time, a Rock, Paper, Swords, it's goodbye from me, Matthew Harfy.
And it's goodbye from me, Stephen A. Mackay.
And remember, whatever action and adventure you have going on in your life, be kind, stay safe, and happy reading.